Few places in the world have a reputation as mysterious as Timbuktu. It's a fabled place synonymous with remoteness and myth. However, since 2007, Hay on Wye has been twinned with this remarkable and distant place. The small Welsh border town, renowned for its bookshops and literary festival, was chosen over 52 other British towns to twin with Timbuktu, the ancient city in Mali on the edge of the Sahara Desert in Africa. The two places may be thousands of miles apart, but they are connected by the one thing that has shaped civilization: literature. Acclaimed author Tom Bullough has selected four teenagers from the local school to make a literary journey to visit their twin town and pen friends 2,500 miles away.
Essentially, I'm here to try and sharpen up their skills and help them put across their enthusiasm for the project on the page in a way that can be understood by everybody else.
Laura, Ellie, Emma and Ollie will travel by air, water and road to get to Timbuktu. This is not your average school trip. It is their first step into the world of the writer. From now on, they must start to live and think as writers do, to see and feel what's around them, gathering thoughts and reflections. For them, there's no turning back. They're entering a world that will change their lives forever. They're officially out of their comfort zone. They've made the journey from Wales to Timbuktu. They're 2,500 miles from home, and Ollie, Emma, Laura and Ellie have finally arrived in Timbuktu. For all its reputation, it is in fact a small city of only 34,000 people. First off, a visit to the tourist office for some unusual paperwork.
Qu'est-ce que je peux faire pour vous, s'il vous plaît?
Can we have our passport stamp?
D'accord. No problem.
Guaranteed to impress even the most jaded of immigration officers, these stamps, complete with a little image of a camel, also allow entrance to an exclusive club in New York.
That's good.
Yeah. We just got ourselves stamped.
It's now official.
We're tourists. It's official. From Hay to Timbuktu, it is official. You know, we are actually here. It's not just a film set. It's actually Timbuktu.
But this is no holiday. They're here to work. An English teacher from the local lycée school takes the students on a tour of the town before dark. It is said that people don't own Timbuktu, they just happen to live there for a while. The city has remained while many empires and invaders have come and gone. It's a combination of geography and climate that allows people to survive here. But the city certainly has an illustrious past that belies its shabby exterior. In the 15th century, thousands of students passed through the Sankore University. And to this day, it still has three ancient mosques and over 100,000 books dating from that period. So Ollie, Emma, Laura and Ellie are the latest in a long line of students who have come here to write.
I'm just in shock.
It's absolutely beautiful. It's so different to the other towns, like little villages and towns we've seen as well. It's like all the architecture is like quite different everywhere, like there's a mixture of limestone and mud bricks. And the windows and the doors, they're all so beautifully done.
Small niches, passages, litter and children. I weave down claustrophobic alleys. The feeling of being trapped is amplified by the darkening path ahead. I am tired, but I am here.
People are very friendly. They find lots of things very funny. The children are absolutely in love with the cameras. They're just like, photo, photo! And you take one, you show it to them, they're like, ah, photo! Like, they're just so happy. Everyone is like, you just wave and they wave back and they're smiley. You know, they're really, really nice.
With daylight fading fast, they need to find their way back to their hotel. A young boy appears and guides them home. As a visitor in Timbuktu, you're never alone for long. Later that night, Ellie and Laura decide to print some photos of the children they met in the streets. They hope to find them again in a few days and hand deliver them as postcards to the little girls.
Spiky girl. Oh, You let me take this. Now I give it back to you. I still have the memory.
Your face, my camera. We are now united forever. Remember with this picture.
Life starts soon after dawn in Timbuktu, before the heat of the day builds. The students are up early as well and head to the lycée, their sister school. They're going to try and sit in on some classes and also look for their pen friends, who they've been in email contact with, but never met. The short walk to the school gives them a pleasant insight to street life in the town. As they near the school, the streets begin to fill with young people their own age. Before long, they're surrounded by inquisitive teenagers, and they find themselves amongst friends.
A curious glance, a whispered remark, a nervous wave, a hesitant greeting, a firm handshake. Let us be strangers no more. The world needn't be black and white. Why not mix the two and relish in the new colours created?
We just arrived at the school. It's absolute chaos.
What is your name?
Oh, Emma.
My name is Fatima.
My name is Fatima.
The Welsh students make their way to a classroom where there's a chance to ask the Malians about their parallel lives.
What makes you happy? What's the thing you do that makes you really happy?
Music. Studying. When he's studying, he's happy.
One of the guys, which kind of made me laugh, said that he enjoys studying. That's what makes him happy. Whereas back at home, if someone asked us that, we'd say studying was what makes us unhappy. So that was quite funny. I find that quite interesting that he enjoys that.
What are you scared of?
In Britain, we never really have that massive threat of war, whereas for them, like, that's on their kind of top, you know, what they're scared of. But for us, you know, that kind of is in the back of my mind. And hunger as well. Obviously, like, I'm never really hungry to the point that I'm starving, so I've never had that. And it's like, scary that like, that's what they're scared of, if you know what I mean. But, yeah, that was always worrying, I guess. It's so odd because there's lots of similarities and lots of differences, and the similarities are what kind of connect us, I guess.
Two different worlds, but the same people.
Well, after searching around the school, I finally found my pen friend, the lovely Faith Nicole. She is even more lovely than I imagined her.
Hello, my name is Faith Nicole. Je comprends pas anglais, but I'm French.
This is Salah Hasse, my pen friend. We talked over email, so yeah.
This is Adema, my pen friend, who I've been emailing.
I've got a present to give to my pen friend. So could you tell her I have a present to give her?
I'm going to make a good one.
Okay.
There
you
go. The four have been in Timbuktu for less than 24 hours and already have a sizable following.
We all have our own footprints, but in the end, we are all on the same voyage.
Back at the hotel pool, they have a chance to cool down and gather their thoughts. They prepare some writing, ready to email to their mentor, Tom Bullo, back in Wales. The school has a surprisingly well-equipped IT centre.
We're all sending a bit of writing to Tom so he can kind of look through and kind of edit bits maybe and help us out. And the internet is moving at a glacial pace, so it's a bit hard.
Tom will read the work in progress and offer his advice and support when they return to Wales. Laura and Ellie are off to find the young children from the photographs they took. But it's not easy. Word spreads ahead of them, and soon they're crowded by children, all claiming to be the ones in the photo. Laura also has some bags of clothes to give away, which adds to the scramble.
We got one girl at least. I think two of them got it. The other bag went somewhere.
Leaving two very happy little girls behind them, they head back to their hotel. After a brief rest, the group are treated to a demonstration of song and dance by a local cultural dance troupe. There's concern in Timbuktu about the dilution of tradition by the increase of Western influences. Events like this are common in an attempt to encourage young people to hold on to what is theirs. It has been a long and exciting first day in Timbuktu for the four. But it seems they really have helped secure the twinning between Hay and Timbuktu. Early the next morning, and the group, including their pen friends, are heading out of town. But they don't know where. They're dropped off on the banks of the River Niger.
Are we going on a boat? Ellie, we're going on a boat!
We're going on a boat.
The mystery tour is revealed. It's time to try and find hippos. They travel in a pinasse, a motorized canoe, on a 4-hour river cruise. The complete calm of the river comes as a welcome break from the frenetic last few days. Thoughts and writing start to flow.
Life on the Niger. A life beyond my imaginings. Unchanged for centuries. The only trace of the modern world is our own lonely boat, its engine droning as we cut through the placid waters.
As we go by all these people, we get one long lingering glimpse into their lives and their cultures and their families before we slide on by.
Somebody said there's hippos over there, but I can't quite see them. I can see like a black log thing. That might be it. I'm not sure.
Oh my god. We've seen
hippos. Bit scary, they're not in cages.
I feel like I'm watching like an old Disney film or something. It's really weird. So happy. They're so sweet though, and they kept like making big noises on in the water as they came on. Like, kind of thing.
The Malian for hippo is Mali, so they call their country hippo. Bit odd. Again, we call our country Wales.
Back on dry land, they experienced the downside of twinning with a town in Wales.
It's raining!
In Timbuktu. And it's not even the rainy season.
Why does Wales follow us?
Everywhere.
That's not fair.
This is unfair. It's a cloud above your head.
I know. Just because we're Welsh, we get rain.
To console themselves, they decide on a bit of retail therapy.
Oh, we're going to the market, and it looks like it's going to be crazy, so I'm just bracing myself a bit to be haggled at. You go back.
No, it's trade that spurs these young people to learn English, and Timbuktu has long been a trading center. The Tuareg, tribes people of the desert, have a fierce reputation for driving a hard deal. But they hadn't bargained on four young shoppers from Wales.
How much?
This one?
Yes.
It's a lot of money.
At home I pay about 1,000 for that.
The turban sellers strike gold with our young adventurers. 5 meters of brightly coloured cloth to protect you from sand and snow. But you need to know how to wear one.
I don't know how to put this on yet. No, I'll look on the internet, mate. I'm sure there'll be a page how to put on a turban.
Salam alaikum!
Timbuktu's most exceptional treasure is its manuscripts. Dating back as far as the 11th century, their contents are a valuable source of West African history and Islamic thought. The books are here because Timbuktu was a centre of learning, and a fabled route of ink led from Timbuktu across the desert to North Africa. Since its twinning with Hay on Wye and its tradition of books, this route of ink now reaches Wales. It is this journey that our students are following. It leads them to the Mama Hydra Centre, a privately owned library that preserves, catalogues, and contains over 9,000 manuscripts. They're shown some that are 600 years old.
We find this very interesting because at home we live in Hay on Wye, which is it's famous for the second-hand books, but they're not nearly as old as any of the ones here.
The manuscripts, centuries of history and philosophy, are here in this precise, beautiful lettering. Somehow, they have survived the wearing of time that grinds high mountains down. And now, against all the odds, they're being restored to their proper glory. This is writing, the skill that we have come here to learn, but our hasty scribbles seem little in comparison.
Each manuscript has a different kind of subject that it focuses on. This one here, astronomy. This one, geometry again.
The combination of art and writing has inspired Ellie.
Because this is what I've been looking forward to most, actually getting to see the writing. So, yeah, I'd love to maybe learn a bit or try to write some.
The ancient art of writing manuscripts is dying out. The group visit the workplace of one of the only people still using the same ancient technique of reed, pen and parchment. Ellie is feeling the frustration of not being able to read Arabic.
It's right here, but I just can't read them, I can't understand them. Writing is just the world. I mean, it passes on stories, it passes on knowledge, it passes on lives, and where would we be without it?
Siddiqui, the scribe, gives them a demonstration. And at last, Ellie gets to try her hand at the ancient art of scribing.
Feels it's like scratching on paper. I was hoping to write writing in the Arabic letters, but it doesn't quite translate because they've only got three vowels, while we've got five, so instead we're going to have to change it slightly to fit the language. It's much more difficult than I thought. Feeling proud of that.
Timbuktu is divided according to people's trades. This evening, the goat herders are holding a dance in their quarter. It's a rare privilege for the students to experience an event like this, pure Timbuktu culture, with their ancient dances and entrancing rhythms. Everyone is made to feel welcome.
One community connected through music and dance. We move to the rhythm. The drums beat out their constant pattern. They don't stop. A slow, steady dance that goes on and on until you feel delirious and your worries dissolve.
It is only women that play the drums while the men dress up. There's a culture of dashing or giving the drummers money as they play if you're enjoying the music. Emma shows her appreciation in the traditional way. The young children join in too. And it seems as though the whole town has arrived, all united by the rhythm of life and the primal urge to dance. In true Mali style, they carry on well into the night. It's their last day in Timbuktu. They're up early and head to the market to buy some souvenirs and make a few notes. It now seems as though Ellie, Ollie, Emma and Laura have really found their voices in Timbuktu. They are like fledgling writers that can embrace and write about any situation with energy and enthusiasm. The heat and dust of the market becomes too much, so they leave the town behind and head out to a real-life Garden of Eden. A small patch of irrigated land that provides nourishment for both body and soul.
we've just driven out, seemingly into like the middle of the desert, to Pasanoa's garden. And we're just going to be shown about here. And already there's just like an explosion of green, which is a bit of a contrast from the yellow sand.
I've written food in the floor because the people here, they're here because all the animals have died and they have nowhere else to go. So this is their way of, you know, making a living and getting food.
But it's through this place that they regain hope, and through that hope they can grow food, and then through that hope they can give it to more people who are suffering, and it's just it's a really nice cycle.
This windmill, you know, pumps all the water to make all this grow, and it's just one simple, like, mechanism, and it makes all of this. It's just crazy how simple it can be.
Such a miracle that a place should exist, where plants grow in the desert's golden soils, and where desperate men are given hope through a living, in return giving others hope of food. A righteous cycle, an astonishing feat.
It was hard to conceive of the effort, the determination and the immortal faith that must have gone into the work that produces a green fortress, steadfast against the ravages of the desert. We felt compelled to tread lightly over Mother Nature's beauty and the potential of true faith.
As though applauding the young writer's fruition, the sun comes out. The group decide to head for Timbuktu's beach on the banks of the Niger. To mark the moment, Ellie is going to leave something behind.
The stone is off the riverbank, which is where I live, and I see the River Wye as like a... For me, it's like what the River Niger is here. It just becomes my life. It's what I kayak on, it's what I swim in, and it's just such a beautiful place to be, and so this is what reminds me of it. Visiting from a distance, I've come to stay.
Only one beast on earth can survive for any time in the desert.
That good camel, yeah, I want the nice one.
And they are partly responsible for Timbuktu being here. But that doesn't make them any more lovable. To complete the Timbuktu experience, the four are off on a camel ride. Very different to pony trekking in the Black Mountains.
It's like a horse, but a lot bigger. I feel like I could fall off quite easily, but it's all good. It's soft landing.
The floor suddenly seems friendly and nice.
I am a true Tuareg, and I am a pro at camel riding. Now I wish.
That's the kind of offbeat rhythm I was feeling when I was riding on the camel, and it felt like it would be nice and creative to incorporate that into my music, because it seems to be what a lot of Malian and sort of desert music is, seems to be structured around, that kind of rhythm. So I'll play a little bit, just think of something.
That night, the group are invited for a farewell feast with the mayor, and Ollie provides the entertainment. It is an event tinged with sadness, as their departure is imminent. Their last few hours in Timbuktu are spent with their new friends. Buka, a local guitarist, gives Ollie a lesson in his style of Tamashek music.
Music has the power to break through all linguistic barriers, and I'm grateful for that. The man who sits across from me may have an entirely different language in life to my own, but if we can communicate through the guitar, then we can learn from one another, and that is the essential part of travel.
Emma and Laura are beginning to have a new understanding too.
I always kind of hoped that I would learn things from this, and I definitely have, and I'm sure without a doubt I could definitely use it in my life. So. Things like judging people, things like, I think thinking more deeply about things. I think sometimes I just kind of brush over it. It's just, you know, because I like to take a laid-back approach to things, and I think that's a good thing, but for some things I need to think about it a little bit more. I think that's one of the things I'll have to take back.
The ideas and the people are so incredibly friendly. They just greet you and they're smiley, and you know, it's just so much nicer being in a place where people seem actually genuinely pleased to see you. There's no cynicism behind it, there's no sarcasm, and maybe that's what I need, a little less cynicism and sarcasm.
It's early morning and the four start the return journey to Wales, but this time they fly all the way. Their new friends are all at the airport to say goodbye, hopeful that they'll meet again either in Wales or in Timbuktu. They've been away just 10 days, but this experience cannot be measured by the clock. Fortunately, they have their writing to record their experiences, and back in Wales, mentor Tom Bullough is already on the case.
There are essentially two aspects to travel, in my opinion. One of them, of course, is the travel itself. The other, and perhaps even the more important of the two, is reflecting on what you've experienced while you've been away. And that's really where the writing comes in. It's a way of reflecting and of digesting experience. So I'm looking forward to working with them now to help them refine what they've been doing so far, but also to help them write something they can really be proud of.
The experience has left me feeling like a caged animal. I have a hunger for more knowledge and people and experience. Wales is my homeland, it's true, but I simply don't understand how people can go through life stuck on this tiny little island of ours when there's so much in the world to be explored.
The pen demanded my concentration. It wanted to follow its own path along the fine grooves in the rough paper. It needed a firm hand to keep it on path, and as I learnt to use my pen, so I discovered a new path of my own.
And so, we return. Not so long after we left. I almost expect our society to have altered in some way after having experienced so much. Yet here it is, in the same comfortable niche, as unknowing as distant world as Timbuktu itself.
Although I love being back here with my family and friends, in the green Welsh hills, I still want to go to Timbuktu. I feel that I am a happier person now. I've always tried to be positive, but seeing how positive people are in Mali, in spite of all their problems, has made me want to try more than ever.